grown up. I need to speak up. I don't want to grow up. Don't want to end up caught in a landslide with the other side. Living for the paycheck, dying for the weekend. Take another Xanax, cheating on your girlfriend, taking your last breath, counting down the time. Don't tell me it's too late. I'm stuck at heaven's gate.
Strike a match and start a wildfire.
I don't recognize Trace anymore.
Yeah, now that the judgment is verified, things are just really different.
Listen,
we have a total shift in our like dynamic. Like it's just like I'm afraid to like say certain things because he's just gonna be like, "Oh, okay. Well, if you don't want to do the podcast anymore, like no, not that vain, but like."
Ever since Jack decided I was worthy, things are gonna be a little bit different from here on out.
Jack, you guys are on a first name basis.
Well, we're all on a first name basis.
Yeah, because it was simply Jack. What a fucking... That's like so shitty of him to do that. Don't you think?
For all the Jacks.
Also, is Jack... For all the Jacks, period. Is Jack short for something? It's got to be short for Jackson, don't we think?
Aren't like John's Jack for some reason?
Are John's Jack?
Like, that's one of those... Jack is a nickname for John.
I literally, in quotes, I love, aren't John's Jack for some reason. I love that sentence. They might be for some reason.
More like Jack off, this guy.
Oh my god, Trace. Hey! No.
Jack, given name.
But...
It can be used as diminutive for John, Jacob, Jason, John... Anything with a fucking J, you're Jack.
Okay. Hey.
They don't care. What a strange name.
Jackathon.
You don't see a lot of Jacks.
Yeah, it's a strange one.
Jackoff ruined it. One of those words. I was saying, like, why would anyone go by Dick at all?
I have an uncle named Dick.
I think I might do it.
But notice that it's uncle and not peer.
Yeah, it's definitely an outdated name now. Something happened.
I think there's a certain power that comes with the name Dick, and I might hold on to that if I was given the opportunity.
I like that.
Especially like you're a huge muscular man. You're like, hi there, I'm Big Dick.
Oh my god, ew.
Welcome to Cinema of the State, the first ever Blink 182 and film discussion podcast. Baby.
Welcome.
We're here.
Usual hosts, Mike and Trace here, but there's a new voice here. Maybe you know him as part of the Rock Outfit Museum Mouth. Maybe his solo work, Gay Meat. Maybe the podcast, It Rocks or It Sucks. Maybe... him posting photos of his house.
Oh my god, you got it. Literally the only one that really matters is my slight involvement with the band Say Anything. That's the one that that's the only way people know.
Oh yeah, also maybe as the man who was part of the last Say Anything record and maybe broke up the band.
He broke up Say Anything.
Maybe. I'm just kidding. I love that was a rumor for a minute. It's really cute. I like definitely needed that on my moral conscience, you know.
Do we add that to the Wikipedia?
Yes. Oh my god. It's so funny. Say Anything fan made me my own personal Wikipedia and like added me to the Say Anything one, but then I kept getting deleted and he like every time he DM'd me be like, "I'm so sorry." And I'm like, "I don't care." Like I love your dedication to this. Like it's doing something for my ego most definitely, but hi, my name is Karl Kuehn.
Welcome. There's one other thing you've been a part of that I didn't mention to Mike because...
I'm really trying to get you on this Wikipedia page, but it won't fucking stick.
I wanted to reveal this to Mike on air. You were a guest on a podcast that... This isn't the first Blink 182 podcast you've been a part of.
It surely
isn't. You were a guest on the Blink 155 podcast.
Why is this so funny? I'm concerned.
A show that we have an unofficial beef with. It's been because
one-sided.
Yeah, one-sided beef. They mostly just mentioned us not by name one time, and then ever since then we've held a grudge against them. On an episode where it was the episode where Nate Ruiz came on as a guest, they mentioned that there's a new Blink-182 podcast out there with, quote, two comedians that like to take the piss out of Blink, and that they and that they talk about movies or something. And we just felt like it was a little bit of a hit, and so they get brought up from time to time on the show.
So at the end of this, we're gonna ask you which one you had.
We're gonna ask which one's better.
Oh, I love this.
Passive aggressive podcasting is what gets shit
I
done.
Would. I hate to do this to you all so quickly, shoot you down so soon. But I would argue I talked about a better song on there.
No.
I like not to be hateful, but y'all really gave me slim pickings.
We kind of had bad timing when we started actually reaching out for other people than our friends to come onto the show. Because by that point, it was like we were already like past self-titled. And it was like, all right, everybody.
Here are the scraps.
There are bangers. There are bangers in this era, though.
There's some.
In the, what's it called? The Matt Skiba era?
Yeah, is that what we're calling it?
That's the Matt Skiba.
Tom's gone.
The Matt Skiba John Feldman era.
Tom DeGone.
Tom DeGone.
I'll be here all week.
Tom DeLong gone, baby.
Oh, that's sad.
It's been like 5 years now.
It has been a really long time. The craziest thing about time is that it just keeps going.
Yeah. God, that's crazy. What I'm always saying.
It's like one day I'm 18 and now I'm 24 and it's like, where's Tom DeLonge been?
Tom DeLonge. I am literally in a toxic relationship with the passing of time. I think I tweet that once a week. It's really nauseating.
I mean, we record this podcast about once a week, and so this is kind of like a mental check-in period for me of the week. It's like, damn, it's been... 1 week has gone by already.
It's been.
Do you remember the Vine that was like of the phone sitting on the table and it would play the beginning of that song, just the It's Been, and it was like a picture of Ben Affleck that would pop up? Like someone was calling, like Ben Affleck was calling the person. Explaining a Vine in 2021 is truly like the most embarrassing thing you could ever do.
Oh, what?
I just did it.
Do you mean a TikTok?
It's only 6 seconds.
Yeah, I have seen a TikTok. I have an account on that app, but it makes me feel 900,000 years old.
I refuse to create a TikTok because my wife has one, and so I just live vicariously through her, and so I won't make one.
That's actually such an amazing point. I think that the most healthy thing you can do in a relationship is like each one of you have your own app. Like I unfortunately love Twitter, and my boyfriend has an account but does not use it, has probably not tweeted in like the past like 5 years. I'm like, okay, that is healthy for us, I think.
I'm all over Twitter. Annie has one, but she tweets not as not as frequently as me.
I've just in the past like dated girls where I'm like, you know, if you're not gonna listen to my podcast, or like every single one of my tweets, this isn't gonna work.
Wow. Okay. I see you as a future bachelor, bachelorette contestant.
Oh, bro! Finally,
bringing that level of fire to CBS or whatever it plays on.
Mike, are you single right now?
Hell yeah, baby! I'll go on The Bachelor. It's on and off. There's like 6 months of like where I'm not, 6 months where I'm not. You never know. I don't talk about it. I'm not like Trace, because like if I was Trace, I would like never bring up being married, because I'd be like, what if we get divorced?
Okay, that is well, with that attitude, I'm just kidding.
That's why like I never bring, like I'm like, if I'm dating a girl, I don't talk about it on here. I'm like, I don't want it to be I guess dated. When someone listens
from
back,
this one
like,
time Mike was in a relationship that he is no longer in. Whoa, crazy.
Wow, you guys are both sick. I'm just kidding.
I didn't do anything. I talk about my lovely wife all the time.
Yeah, you think I love that. Love is literally iconic.
Thank Wife you. Guy. Karl, what's your history with Blink-182, if any?
I adore this band. This band, like, really was incredibly formative to me and for me.
Finally.
I came in, unfortunately, I was, like, a smidge late on, like, for my era. I came in with Enema of the State. It was the first CD I ever bought with my own money.
Wow.
I know. Isn't that so cute? It was like part of like a haul of like three. It was like that, the Sixpence and the Richer record with Kiss Me on it. And then I think the third one might have been Maybe You've Been Brainwashed Too by New Radicals, but I could be wrong. But I like the only one I loved out of that little set was Enema of the State. So I don't know. I've just always loved this band. And I was like one of those apologists that like when Neighborhoods came out, I was like, honestly, y'all, this bangs ass and hole. This is like way better than it should be. But then like, you know, the Skiba era, it did kind of like cut me in a way I wasn't expecting to be cut. And I wasn't necessarily as obsessed as I should or could have been.
I've been betrayed by Blink.
I think 9 is cool. Is that crazy to say?
Well, so we
don't
we
know.
Haven't listened to 9.
Oh, you've never
Neither
listened.
Of us have never heard 9. We're on our way.
And this has been our first listen of California.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Because, like, Trace's history is a little less than mine. Because mine basically is that I got really into them right before Neighborhoods came out.
Okay.
And then I was kind of bummed out by Neighborhoods.
Wait, no! I literally just sounded like Don Vito from People of Bam. That's not true. Neighborhoods is like literally iconic. It's sickening.
Well, like, how do you feel about Angels and Airwaves?
Bad.
I think it's like it's Tom forcing Angels and Airwaves onto Blink 182.
But I kind of like that. Angels and Airwaves on paper should be like incredibly up my alley. I remember being like a teen and hearing like that first, like, Here Love, Here I Am song and being like, what happened? Like, okay, Tom DeLonge discovered the delay pedal and was like, I gotta quit the band.
Have y'all seen like, this shit?
Yeah, okay, so like, truly that like shows up with like the Boss delay pedal that everyone has and is like, oh my god, guys. But like I liked that in theory. I was like, Tom DeLonge discovering delay pedal is cool. So when they started applying it to Blink, I was like, okay, I'm here for this.
See, Mike is a little more harsh on Neighborhoods than I am, but I'm definitely not totally with it. Like, I'm not a Neighborhoods defender by any means. I know, like, Mike seems like he really has a disdain for it.
Because Tom has a disdain for them in that album. Tom did not want to be in the band.
I mean, that's...
Do you know, like, the production of that album at all?
I know that it was, like, Mark and Travis doing their thing in A studio and Tom doing his thing in B studio. But that happened to the Strokes too. So like I'm not that arc is not that crazy
which,
to me.
Which album did the Strokes do that for?
But what
Angles.
Okay. And that's a good album. So it can work.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it seemed like were the other albums but I don't know the Strokes as well, but like were the other albums like all like together the way Blink-182 albums seem to be?
More or less, yes.
Because that just seems like Tom and Mark just have more of a dynamic where they need to be in the same room and doing, like, emails or whatever, like, just didn't seem to work for them.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's tea.
It's been documented.
And same thing with Dogs Eating Dogs, or what was that called?
Dog.
I almost said Dogs Versus Dogs.
Dogs Versus Dogs. I hate that EP. That EP is
really
bad. I don't like it.
I think like when we do a rank, we usually do a ranking of everything. I think our ranking was like each song like as it came out.
Yeah.
Like, just chronological order. Just chronological.
Yeah, that EP like literally just like declined in quality as you go down the track list.
Does it close?
And wasn't that like your favorite at one point?
The Dogs Eating Dogs EP?
Trace.
Yeah.
Weren't you listening to that?
Yeah,
a lot
in
high school,
I was like, "This Dogs Eating Dogs EP is like so fucking sick," and I had like never heard any, I had like never listened to any Blink 182 except like the greatest hits, and I was like, "But I love this EP."
Oh my god, Trace, that is so cursed. But it's your...
It ends with a rap verse, yeah. Carl.
Is that
I don't
the
know
Yellow
remember.
Wolf?
That's
is that
yellow,
Yellow
the
Wolf?
Yellow Wolf.
I was like, I don't like
the
Yellow
only
Wolf.
Time I've ever heard of Yellow Wolf.
Yeah. There's like... Does he look crazy? One of them looks crazy. I'm Googling on my phone to
Travis
make it happen
looks
fast.
Pretty nuts.
I don't think Travis...
I mean, all those tattoos. he looks like a cowboy in this one picture. I see. Okay. He's wearing
That's
a lot of cowboy
hats. He's not the one I'm thinking of. There's another one like him that looks really crazy. Mm. Another one like him. That sounds so insane. But in my mind, that he's part of like a population of people that occupy a space. And
yeah,
one of them.
I don't know. I was a freshman in high school and was like, yeah, this is sick. And I mean, to this day, my favorite Blink-182 album is the Greatest Hits album.
Yellow Wolf. That's called Howling.
Oh my god. Badumching. I actually kind of agree with a statement like that, but it applies to 311's greatest hits is their best
oh,
album
yeah.
period. And then they also have like an essential.
You put all
now.
The best hits in there, baby.
Yeah,
it's in the title. It's the greatest hits. How can you get better than
it
that?
Really they're like one of those.
Has a band ever released like these are our worst songs?
Oh, Museum Mouth. We did that last year.
That fucking rules.
Yeah.
Here's a compilation of shit.
They're literally, that is such a thing. We like literally release like a comp of like singles, B-sides, and rarities. And there's one song that's like a minute long that is our old guitarist Graham singing about playing hide and seek in the style of Black Flag. Like, it's like really a mess. Like when the numbers, when our like monthly listeners did not jump up because of that, I was like, eh, makes sense.
These are I had fun.
Yeah, it was for
These
me.
These are the ones we knew
really.
We couldn't get away with.
Yeah, incredibly that vibe.
So that brings us to Wildfire, which was released on May 11, 2017 as the fourth single of the band's deluxe edition of California. Ooh. It's a song about giving up on life, suicide, and finding your way out of the bottom.
Hey, thank you, genius.com.
Hell yeah. The genius is on genius.com.
Are there any annotations on this one?
There's...
Well, we've started a thing recently, Carl, where we now do our own annotations at our own little... basically vandalize the website genius.
Okay, yes. Love that.
You know, and of course, like, these are, like, the track 23 on the deluxe edition of California. I don't think anyone's, like, going that far deep to, like, check if anyone's making any bad choices on here.
I mean, some, like, really dedicated fan will find it and be like, this is not what the song's about.
Have you guys heard this podcast? Sorry.
The lyrics to this song are troubling to me.
In what way?
It's like the lines, there's an annotation on this, so I'm gonna click and see what it says. So in the first verse we've got dying for the weekend, and then the next two lines are take another Xanax, cheating on your girlfriend. I'm
not,
like
not
cool.
Wait, not cool. And then the next lines are taking your last breath, counting down the time. I'm like, okay, what is going on here?
Well, let's get into that a little deeper, Carl. If you want to take the full verse one, if you want to start Mark from
what?
Top
okay,
to bottom.
I'll read.
Let's see what's going on
okay.
here.
Okay, so from line one, it says, I could never own up. I need to speak up. I don't want to grow up. Don't want to end up. Caught in a landslide with the other side, living for the paycheck, dying for the weekend. Take another Xanax, cheating on your girlfriend, taking your last breath, counting down the time.
Okay, and now I would like to read this because the take another Xanax and cheating on your girlfriend line is already annotated. Genius user...
Sucks I can't add my interpretation.
I mean, we could...
It's a long
Yeah,
annotation.
We could suggest an improvement to this one if we don't like it. The beginning of it is just explaining Xanax. Thank you. And
nice.
And it's really long. I don't want to read all of it, but it says, let's see, these the lines are sung by Hoppus. It's likely they were inspired by experiences of Matt and Travis with drugs and relationships. Because Mark is in fact known to be the soberest member of the band. I don't know what that's in reference
to.
Congrats,
Mark. There's a link to our Reddit thing.
The geniuses over at the geniuses Blink over 182. On Reddit. We'll figure it out.
Blink 182 and drugs.
Is that the title of the conversation on Reddit? It says Matt had an experience of Xanax addiction after breaking up with his girlfriend, while Travis was actually on Xanax on the night of his plane crash. From his autobiography, I felt weird about the whole situation, weirder than usual, and I smoked blunt after blunt on the way to the airport. Plus, I took 3 Vicodin and a Xanax to get right. This draws a dark parallel with the title of the song, since Travis's body was 65% burnt after the accident. He took several months to recover. Okay, now I read that, and I was like, I hear Travis talking to Mark. He was like, do we really got to call it Wildfire? Like, I don't... This is one of those things that, like, I don't know that this is, like, exactly what they were going for with the song. One of those big...
I think that this annotator is out of their mind.
One of those giant genius reaches that is completely insane.
I just remembered this is this line about Xanax, and it's like, now we're talking about burn.
Yeah.
And we're talking about his like, burns. I'm like, oh, shit.
It has to be...
Oh, wait, so Travis was, like, freaking toked out during that?
Yeah, okay, I just want to point out in that, I think the idea of smoking blunt after blunt, taking 3 Vicodin and a Xanax to, quote-unquote, get right, is the most...
Sounds miserable.
That's not... There's nothing right about that. You're a different person after you take that many substances.
And then crash a plane.
Well, he wasn't flying. Travis, yet.
I know he wasn't,
like,
but
he's
then
piloting. Yeah.
No one
hijacked it. Crashed. I'm taking over.
Oh my god, y'all are literally. I don't know if you are commonly. If you commonly know you're going to hell, but you're definitely going to hell now. Period.
I have like over 80 hours of proof that I am.
Okay, yeah, you're serving.
It's called cinema of the state.
Overtime in hell. Pay and a half in hell. I think that this is like, I just have to empathize with anyone in this band. If I ever was in Blink 182 and stumbled across this annotation, I would truly be dissociating for a long period really of time after reading. Because it's just like, it's really
weird. It's very
weird.
Bizarre. It is. It doesn't make any sense.
So I could never own up. I need to speak up. I don't want to grow up. Don't want to end up caught in a landslide. So Mark's in his public speaking class at college.
I mean, I just wanted to say about these lyrics. this follows the trend of this whole album where, like, I think this song is, like, kind of okay. Yeah.
Musically,
but then, like,
definitely.
It has a real, like, Tony Hawk video game.
Melodically,
vibe.
I can definitely hear that. But then you get into the lyrics and it's like, what is this about? Like, I don't, of course we've talked about the production of this album, like, to no end. And it's the same here. It's so, yeah, it is so poppy.
So clean.
And it's like.
But sometimes the drums sound bad. Am I allowed to say
you're
that?
To say whatever you want.
Go for it.
Sometimes.
If Travis Barker hears this, that would be the most shocking. Like, If there's, like, beef between, like, oh, man, Museum Mouth and Travis Barker, beef.
No beef there. No beef there. I'm doing the, like, thing.
I'd be like, wow, Travis.
There's no beef there. Don't worry.
I'd be like, Travis Barker, listen to my podcast?
I just think, like, I was using 9. This is, oh, my God, this is so embarrassing. I was using 9 as mixed reference last year. Because I was like, this record sounds really good. And the drums, like, pop so much more on 9 than on California. California, honestly, like, my band's production in the past has sounded like ass and hole. But, like, California doesn't sound much better, in my opinion. Is that crazy to say?
I mean,
at least when it comes to drum production.
I think a lot of California,
it's like a little
sounds
muffled.
Like shit, so.
It's weird. That's just me on a very small soapbox. And I could literally change my opinion tomorrow. So, like,
don't take anything Karl
says. Don't quote me on it, but... Once upon a time, I was listening to it, and I thought it sounded bad.
He's going to DM, like, a full, like, 2 minutes of, like, this is what I think now. Can you just layer that
in?
Yeah,
yeah. I'm going to record my own audio and send it to you.
I changed my opinion. When you guys start talking about this verse in the song, can you just make sure, like, I don't say that, and now I say, this is actually, like, the greatest song I've ever
heard.
Yeah,
and I do it in, like, a different voice, in, like, a funny voice.
Whoa! I just sound...
Oh my god, I like that voice.
Oh, that's my thing on here. The other day I said, like, I have a full range of voices I've seemed to be able to do on the podcast, but for some reason I'm sticking
Mike
with this one.
Mike is an expert voice artist. He has many impressions that he's amazed me with over the course of the time on here.
He's amazed me with. I love that. I did also too.
I'm the Frank Caliendo of Cinema of the State.
Who's that?
I did also just want to say this song structurally doesn't make any sense to me.
Okay, let's look. First chorus, verse.
It's just because verse two specifically is so short, especially compared to verse one.
Yeah,
and then it goes straight back. Yeah, it goes straight back into the chorus, and then they add on a post chorus, and then there's just kind of a bridge to the outro, and then it ends really abruptly at the end. So it feel like the first minute or so of the song, I feel like they're onto something, and then it kind of falls apart somewhere around verse two.
But I think with this band, specifically on this record, I think that they are playing with such traditional song structures that it's just like, you know, there's like song structure A, song structure B, C, D, and E. This is probably like song structure E, where they're like, you know, we can do the short little half verse second time around. And then tack on like the weird. This is like, I would call this code name like weird ending, where it's like you do the post chorus into the outro or post chorus into bridge outro and then done. Like, you know, that's like the weird ending we can choose to go with. I just feel like writing songs for these people, it's like not ever, probably at this point, like it's probably like there's such an awareness of it. Like, you know, you're not just like, I'm going to follow the song where it needs to go. It's like, this is going to fit this thing that we've done 10,000 other times.
And I guess this is also just part of like a collection of bonus tracks essentially for this album, even though it was like promoted as like a whole other album.
And I feel like I've liked a lot of these second half songs like somewhat more than some of the
some of these are better than
regular.
Yeah, Carl, have you listened to Deluxe California?
No, when you told me my options, I was like, what are these songs? I was like fiercely like Googling, trying to find them. I was like, oh, Deluxe California. So no, I hadn't. And then I listened to this one and I listened to, what's the one right after this one? Like 7-8. It's like a time signature song.
6-8?
6-8. Yeah, that's the only other song from these bonus tracks I've ever heard. Oh, I have also unfortunately heard Can't Get You More Pregnant.
We haven't got to that yet.
Oh,
I haven't
boy.
Heard that song.
We know it's a joke one though.
Put it off.
those crazy jokesters, Blink-182, back again with another freaking crazy song.
Is wait, now I'm looking. Is Bohemian Rhapsody on the normal version of this record?
Bohemian Rhapsody.
Oh, Bohemian.
That's the final track.
Wow, interesting.
They have
choices.
they have like a big closing track, and then they actually close with Bohemian Rhapsody. It's like, haha.
Men, I think men making music is just like, no.
That's why I haven't done it.
Like,
that's why
no.
I do a podcast instead.
It's over.
Yeah, I'm glad you got verified for having a podcast and writing online and not for making music.
That's very funny to think that Trey's got verified for having a podcast.
Trust me, I did not try to use my podcast as proof for verification because I knew that would not get me anywhere.
Oh, did you apply? Do you have to apply?
Yeah, you have to apply to get verified.
Wow.
Oh, I mean, unless you're like freaking like joining as like Robert De Niro or someone, like Twitter will probably do it for them. But if you're just fucking Trace Sever,
well, I remember schmuck, you used to apply and then you couldn't apply, and you can apply again.
That's how they just opened it back up to like be more streamlined. Like you just go to your settings and apply now, and like if you get rejected, you can apply again after 30 days.
Ooh,
awkward.
Try again.
The museum mouth account is verified, and when you become verified, the verified account follows you.
Yes.
Trace, yes, you can confirm this. So I DM'd the verified account on the museum of the account being like, verify my other account, please.
Well, so I think if you go to like, I think if you apply for verification, I think they would give it to you because I have a theory. I don't know how the verification vetting works, but now I have a theory that it's basically like Twitter nepotism, where it's like, if you can prove that you are associated with an account, like closely associated with a publication or an institution that has a verified Twitter account, you will get verified. Because I just showed Twitter all the articles I wrote for the Austin Chronicle as an intern, and they have a verified account, and they verified me.
But I do think that it likes writers. It likes people that, like, contribute writing. Because I, like, have contributed writing in the past, too. But it, like, it links to a dead Twitter account now. This is the most boring conversation in the entire world. I'm so sorry. But, like, it links to a dead Twitter account because I famously deleted my, like, big online terror Twitter account when I tried to change my ways and stop tweeting so much.
How did that go?
But it's going well, I think. Life. Okay. I think I'm much less annoyed. I'm old now, so I feel like I just, like, had to, like, get that out of my system, and now I just tweet when it's, like, I'm really bored or I have a genius thought.
So every day.
Yeah, day in and day out. 29 hours.
Twitter just needs to verify
day,
you if you're a genius. Like, they should just scroll through the tweets and realize this guy has a fucking big-ass brain, and we need to verify it.
Yeah, you should be able to take a test to get verified, I think.
If you show a master's degree.
I don't have that.
Automatic verification. Just anyone who's like a doctor.
Oh, I'm going to put gay meat PhD on my account and see if they verify me. I'm not sure if doctors
are important enough for verification.
Is that insulting to doctors to like make fun of having a PhD?
What have they done?
Yeah, actually, that's a great... I've yelled at a lot of doctors, so...
And that's also to, like, the PhD doctors. Those are, like, the friggin', like, just get, like, for being a scientist. They're not, like, saving lives like the MDs. Those are the heroes.
I need you both to know that I just went to change my display name and typed it PDH. It's, like, really hard being a genius. Okay, so shall we move on? I feel literally so bad. Have I derailed being a
genius? Just ask the geniuses on genius.com.
Yeah, make an appointment at the Genius Bar.
What'd they say on the chorus, Trace?
Oh, yeah, on the chorus. Mark Hoppus and Matt Skiba are both on here.
Woo! And both.
They have this to say. Don't tell me it's too late. I'm stuck at Heaven's Gate. Strike a match and start a wildfire. Only you can prevent wildfires. I'll own all my mistakes, won't give you what you take. Watch you burning in the wildfire. So they are not going to help you if they see you in the wildfire.
Very RuPaul Charles of them to just let you die.
Oh, we can talk about him later.
Don't tell me it's too late. Was that perfect pitch? Did I just slay that? The late was bad.
I think Matt Skiba sounds bad on this song.
Okay, I don't agree with you. I kind of think he sounds good. When I was listening to it riding my bike shortly before I got on Zoom, when he started singing, I was like, oh, okay, yes.
There's been others.
What's your opinion on Matt Skiba? Like, are you a... What's his man? Alkaline Trio fan at all?
I never really cared about them. They had like they had a song. I think it was called I have not thought about this in 20 years, but I think it was called Crimson that had a music video that would play when I was addicted. I was raised on music videos. So I'm Googling right now. But I liked that song, but I didn't really like care. It's an album actually. I'm wondering if there's a title track. There's not. So I have no idea what the song was, but I know it was on this record because obviously my TV would tell me that a lot, enough to make me remember that word. But I don't love him. I don't really know anything about him. I know that the internet hates him now because he's a cop supporter.
Yeah.
And I know that when they made that quarantine song, there was a rumor that he was like out of the band, but he was really just maybe in rehab, ?
Oh, that's breaking news to me. I've never heard that.
We'll find out more about that when we cover quarantine at the end of the year or beginning of next year.
That song's really bad.
Great.
Oh, boy. I know what I remember a former guest told us that song, Matt, Matt doesn't have, like, any writing credit or anything on it at all. So that, like, so I wonder who's playing guitar. Travis?
I mean, I can only assume Mark is good at guitar now.
He learned.
I mean, I just feel like bass is not the way, especially the way he plays bass is not that different from guitar. So like, I feel like, you know, he can make it work. Maybe.
Well, on Matt Skiba, like one thing I was always like surprised about with this is that he does replace Tom like in a way that like what I really thought was this would be like the Mark Hoppus album.
Yeah.
And like Matt Skiba's like pretty it. Like all over it.
But also this really song thought. This song feels like Blink 182 drag. Like it like opens with like
a lot of it does.
What's my age again? Guitar into like
first date.
Yeah, into first date, like high shredding vibes and like DB drums. I'm like, okay, it just doesn't sound fresh or new in any way, but I also get like, you know, you're replacing one of your core members with someone new. Like, you don't want to, like, shock your fan base and, like, make something that does not sound
like
you.
Yeah, we've talked about that before, and there's, like, a lot of that on this album. And that's why, like, we've never heard Nine. And so I'm interested to see if they tried anything different with Nine, now that maybe people were more used to having Skiba in the band.
I'm going to pretend like I'm like the NPC in this like an RPG and I'm the NPC that's warning you about what's to come. It is better and different and it is more like okay. them. It's more like the three individual people bringing their own styles, okay. which is nice.
Now I'm hyped for an album that I was not looking forward to at all.
Yeah, I'm literally going to do the you're like young and gay and getting bullied. Like it gets better.
Thank you.
It does.
That's what me and Mike need to hear. It gets better.
Blink 182. It gets better.
I'm going to make an It Gets Better video about Blink 182, not about being gay.
Hey, so what's wrong, son? The kids at school, they don't like Blink 182.
Oh my god, this bit is also why I'm going to hell.
See, like, it'd be fun. Like, we can do another episode there. Like, Satan comes on.
I want to come back. I want to come back for Dark Side off of Nine.
You got it.
Okay, sickening. Because I'm also in a toxic relationship with that song.
You're booked.
Oh, my God. Yes. Yes. Feels so when people ask me what's coming up for 2022, I'm going to tell them that.
2021.
Oh,
boy.
This fall.
It's happening that
fast. I
have
the calendar in my head, baby.
Oh my, I don't know if I trust that. I'm like looking at your Zoom background. I'm like, I don't think that man's calendar is probably right.
I mean, Trace could tell you, like, it's shocking how like much like control I have over this show. Like
file cabinet brain.
Well, it's just because
like the amount of effort I put into it, like in comparison to like how lazy I am with literally anything else. I'm
so
but cinema
of Mike's
the state's
energy
important.
Is dedicated to the show, where most of my energy towards the show is mostly like me showing up and like promoting it every week. The rest of it is pretty much Mike's brainchild. Like any concept episodes or ideas, those are pretty much from the mind of Mike. I'm usually tired at the end of the day and I can't think about it.
That's fair. That's really fair. Having a podcast, especially doing weekly eps, is exhausting.
That's why we like to like have like 2 weeks in advance, just in case like something happens where we have to like stop, but like we don't want to have to like delay the show or that.
Yeah, you guys are smart.
This is kind of some behind the music talk of the podcasting world. I'm sure everyone's getting some great insight on what it's like to run a podcast.
My whole thing is I love to infiltrate and then pull back the curtain. I like to humanize the pillars of the podcast community.
Look, your faves are just like you.
It's very true. And that actually is, I have learned over time that applies to every industry.
That's my PSA, where it's like just like it's a bunch of like famous, it's like Joe Rogan and Mark Maron, it's like podcasters are just like you.
Yeah, in fact, I would argue that Joe Rogan is worse than you.
Yeah, I would say I think we're doing something better here.
No,
than Joe Rogan.
Well, I mean, he puts 3 hours into it, and you know what? He doesn't have to put effort into it. He already got that Spotify bag. Good for him.
There's something so sickening about my arc with Joe Rogan, because I was a child who loved Fear Factor.
Same.
So, like, that's, like, what... He was my god for a little while just because of his involvement with Fear Factor. And then, like, seeing where he is now and what he's doing now, I'm like, honestly, like, humanity should have stopped in 2016 or something. Like, you know, like, I could have died happily knowing him as the Fear Factor guy.
Well, like, the day I found out that Joe Rogan was the Fear Factor guy was, like, the day my life changed. I did not realize they were the same person.
Oh, but, I mean, they made it known every ep of Fear Factor that his name was Joe Rogan.
Hi, I'm Joe Rogan. Welcome to Fear Factor. Pretty evident that was his name, and he was hosting the show.
I did not remember his name. I hadn't watched Fear Factor since I was probably 10 years old.
As a child, you were in it for the stunts. You like tall crappuccino.
They're eating worms! Yeah.
They blend up the bugs.
This man's about to lay in a bed of caterpillars or roaches or whatever.
Caterpillars? That sounds like a dream. It's more like lay in a bed of snakes, period.
See, my relationship with Joe Rogan goes back to me being like 14 and my cousin saying, hey, watch this video of Joe Rogan heckling Carlos Mencia.
No, I don't subscribe to that. That sentence registers not with me.
Do you know? Okay, so what happened was Carlos Mencia.
No, I don't want to know.
I'll go into, like, I know so much about this. The man, like, stole jokes, and then Joe Rogan legit went on stage with his own mic and confronted him.
Okay, wait, that's honestly sickening. I love that. I, like, really love that.
He was like, you steal jokes! He's like, I forget what, like, who the other, he's like, you stole this joke from this guy. And he's like, why would I have stolen that joke? That joke's about being Mexican. He's like, and then, like, Carlos Mencia, if you look him up, like, I think was born not in Mexico. He just made his whole career. His name is, like, Ned.
Okay, that's
Carlos Mencia's name is Ned?
He's Honduran. His name is Ned Mencia. I think he changed his last name after the fact.
Carlos Mencia's
previously
name.
Ned Holness. He was born Ned Holness.
I don't know what to think of this intel. I don't know how to react to this intel. I'm truly just a fly on the wall to a conversation right now. I might let you know when I process this how I feel about it, but I also might not.
We're talking about, like, Wild Wild West, and they're like, yeah, and then Kevin Klein is dressed, has a big beard, he's the president. Like, wait a minute!
Oh my god, yeah, honestly.
Carlos Mencia's name was fake?
It could happen that quickly, but I think it will take longer, unfortunately.
Later in the day, like, you just DM us, like, well, my thoughts on the Carlos Mencia / Ned Holness situation.
Yeah, like, literally 3 a.m. I'm gonna DM you and be like, so I've been thinking, ... I, like, literally, this is such a ride. And we're only through the first chorus.
Oh, God. So, don't tell me it's too late. I'm stuck at Heaven's Gate. Strike a match and start a wildfire. This song handles suicide and depression.
It does it?
It depicts someone who is on the verge of ending his life. It uses Heaven's Gate as a metaphor to what comes after death. Striking a match to start a wildfire is used to showcase someone, quote unquote, pulling the trigger, and how that simple action leads to serious consequences. The Heaven's Gate line has a double meaning, along with the imagery of someone who has just committed suicide and now waits the gates to enter heaven. It is also referenced the religious cult that staged a mass suicide in March 1997, believing a UFO would take their souls. Oh, it's all comes back to the fucking UFOs.
To the aliens.
UFOs would take their souls to another level of existence above human. Mark would know this incident well, since it occurred in Rancho Santa Fe, the San Diego area near where the band formed.
Again, a ton of reaching. I mean,
no, that's not reaching if they're straight up saying Heaven's Gate, though.
I mean, I'm mostly talking about the aliens.
Okay, well, that's what the cult was about, though.
A lot of these songs seemed like, I feel like this is like the third song on this album that is like, or like the third annotation we've seen on this album that has been like, this song's about aliens. And it seems like people just think that because, like, Tom.
Guys, he's gone. Tom's aliens. We're not talking about those anymore.
I don't know. I want
to. I'll own all my mistakes, won't give you what you take, watch you burning in the wildfire. So, Trace, highlight that and just write, "Where are you?" And I'm so sorry. Own his mistakes.
You got it.
That's all I want. I love that we're gonna get kicked off this website one day.
Yeah, probably one day soon.
Tomorrow. I don't really know how I feel about. I think that the annotator is really taking it. They're approaching this very ham-fisted. I don't think that it's about committing suicide. Period.
No. Do you like the GIF though?
What's the GIF? Is it in the annotation? Oh, ooh. Yeah.
Yeah. Look at that match strike.
That's a really solid.
Slow mo.
Wow, this is a long GIF.
It's very long, yeah.
It just lit up.
It goes through the whole process here.
There's a post chorus.
Yeah, let's get through this shit. I want to talk about the movie.
Where Mark Hoppus, Matt Skiba, and Bolf, they go, "We won this war. We cursed and swore. They stood no chance at all," parentheses, "the underdogs came home. We won this war. We cursed and swore. They stood no chance at all." All
right, I hate this word.
It's stupid. So corny.
Yeah, we cursed and swore.
We said, fuck.
Quote tweet that and watch, right, watch your mouth, young man.
Yeah, I don't know about this period.
No.
It's intentionally very G-rated vibes, and it's very
we did cussing,
yes. Rated PG-13 like, just for like, cussing.
It's just like, "We won this war, the underdogs came home." What are y'all? I hate lyrics like this.
Men love, we talk about this on my podcast a lot. Men love to sing about war.
And like, what is that, it good for?
It absolutely nothing. It's just so strange that like that is such a thing. And as someone who's sitting on a song that has like some war imagery, like I get it, but like it's just like, no.
At least like not in this way where it's so like so broadly goofy.
Yeah, like, it's so broad, you're right.
I did annotate one thing on this. I highlighted underdogs, and I just wrote Jason Lee from the film adaptation of Underdog.
Never seen it. Don't know about that.
He plays a superhero dog.
Ooh, I like that.
Yeah.
Now, are you interested?
I am. Yeah, my interest is very piqued.
We need Jason Lee back. As Underdog specifically. I don't care about his other. I don't need Earl back, just Underdog.
I literally was gonna be like, "Has he been on the pod?" And you say we need him back.
That would be the fucking weirdest poll of anyone to come on this show.
Hit him up, you never know.
I'm going for it.
Well, Trace is verified now.
I do know someone who's verified on Twitter.
Yeah, literally, the way the guests are about to live, I feel so lucky that the guests are gonna skyrocket.
I know.
And they're going to do the worst fucking songs to talk about Blink-182.
Yeah, the timing of this is really just... J'adore it.
I mean, okay. We haven't done Dude Ranch or Cheshire Cat yet.
Cheshire Cat.
So
what is y'all's problem?
We wanted to start with Enema of the State.
Oh, because of Cinema.
And then
the
go
state.
Back. Yeah.
I cannot... Like, in another timeline, I'm talking about a song I love.
I mean...
You can come back
in another
You're
timeline.
Welcome.
If we were grading like on the actual curve that it should be graded on, we'd potentially be in neighborhoods territory.
I'm sorry.
Or at least the first half of this actual album where there was like real release songs.
Instead, we got you for the secret back half that came out of here.
Yeah, really. That I learned about 2 weeks ago.
This is the second guest to be like really upset about being on the bonus.
Last week we recorded with our friend Logan, and both of y'all have been like, "Y'all got me on for the bonus half of California." Yeah. Like,
but he seemed to calm down to it once he realized that everybody for the next like 12 weeks is going to be on that.
Okay, yeah, there's solidarity in that.
We're all in this together, folks.
Okay, the bridge is Psycho Boots.
Read it.
"I don't forget, comma, I don't forgive, comma, I'll never change the way I live. I always fought the urge to fall in line. I turned my back on all the rules, comma, I'll never heed the king of fools. I'll never lead the perfect kind of life."
Wow. real insightful shit here.
Bonkers. I don't know how to say this without like sounding like at least semi-callous. Like, obviously, I think that all three members of this band have faced their demons. And I think that anyone pursuing music and then like reaching this level, like obviously your lifestyle is crazy. It has probably been really crazy. I'm not trying to ever like eliminate any of your trauma or lived experiences in a kind of unconventional career. But I do think that once you reach a certain tax bracket, singing about it becomes really foolish.
Yeah, definitely.
Like, I don't think it's weird to say that. I think that's actually probably common sense.
Oh yeah. And again, it's just like the song is written so anonymously too, and on top of yeah. that. So it's just like, again, like I don't mind the way the song sounds, but this is just more of what's indicative of what I don't like about the California album, and it's mostly in the lyricism and kind of the intentions behind it.
Yeah, it's like very much like this could resonate with like the kid who's 14 and into skateboarding in Southern California, and it also could resonate with the guy who's like 31 and cheating on his girlfriend in Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, and about to be deployed.
Or just resonate with like you know, like the dad that brought his son to the baseball game and this is playing over the speakers while he's standing in line to buy a hot dog.
It's truly, like, offensively inoffensive. Yeah.
I'm really picturing that dad now. He's so happy.
He's probably hot as hell.
Yo, he's a hot dad.
In my mind, he's like, smoking hot.
Just beefcake, like, oh my God. 5 o'clock shadow with the big mustache over it, though, and he's just like, I really hope I don't have to pay alimony this month.
I'm literally about to black out.
The outro is the same as the bridge. So I think it's time to head down to the Wicca Wicca Wild Wild West.
Oh my God. Okay. Literally hate that. Yes, we're closing the book on the lyrics, moving into the amazing film.
We are going to be talking about the 1999 Western comedy sci-fi movie Wild Wild West, directed by Barry Sonnenfeld, produced by John Peters.
Woo!
And starring Will Smith and Kevin Kline and Kenneth Branagh and
Salma Hayek.
On June 30th, danger will come from all directions. But the only hope is West.
Jim West.
Will Smith.
Gotta stick to what we each do best.
Kevin Kline is Artemis Gordon, Kenneth Branagh, and Salma Hayek from the director of Men in Black. Wild Wild West. Woo! Monday, the final Mad About You.
A different time for movies when this came out.
A golden era, as I said before we started recording the pod.
this movie could only have come out the year that it had come
1999
out.
1999 was crazy.
It came out in 1999. This blew my mind reading it. This movie was made for $170 million.
Where did they get that much money?
This was the most expensive film ever made when adjusting for inflation at the time of its release.
My jaw was on the floor, and then when I went to close it, I spit everywhere. That is crazy.
I literally could not fucking believe that about this movie. And then I also just could not believe what this movie was about, because I thought this was like some kind of mid-budget, like kind of just goofy little buddy comedy Western romp with Will Smith and Kevin Kline.
No. I lived as a child, I lived the release of this movie, the cinematic release of this movie, and it was a big fucking deal. I think there were toys at Burger King.
Oh, awesome.
Or yeah, like there were definitely toys. Yeah. Wild Wild West. I'm gonna do,
I feel like, is that the Gone Era toys. Is the movie tie-in McDonald's Burger King toy.
I mean, do they still exist? I'm not a child anymore, so I just don't.
I don't even know. Like, I gotta pull through, but I feel like I don't see commercials about
Burger King
ever.
Yes, Burger King. I, as someone who frequents McDonald's, I know that they do. Okay, thank you. Right, I'm gonna save space. I know that they do still do some stuff like that, but typically it's more with like an established franchise of toys and less with like a movie or a film.
I wouldn't be surprised. I feel like there's probably Luca stuff at McDonald's right now. That movie about the fish people would make sense.
I do miss the era of, like, yeah, the movie tie-in toys, and then the movie tie-in games is something I miss too.
Oh, Luca, you got a Happy Meal.
Mike can do that. He's Italian.
Yeah. I'm half Italian X. I can say that.
Italian X. Oh my god. Oh my god, excuse me, I just burped.
Yeah, the actual storyline of this movie, I definitely was not aware of the social and historic implications as a child seeing this.
No.
But as an adult, I was like, oh my god. And that crazy, I know, Mike, I know you tweeted the screenshots, but there's a really wild line delivery where Will Smith talks about slavery.
It's insane.
Who wouldn't want to do chores?
Yeah.
Like, literally.
He turned down The Matrix because he read this script and was like, this is it. But I get it.
Adjusting for the inflation of, like, just the cultural conversation, I do think that it was kind of, like, ballsy for them to be going down this road in 1999 in this crazy movie that was, like, you know, for kids, ? Like, you know, it's like, yeah. I think that there's, like, some respect that needs to be held given the time, Meg.
Well, I also think you have to think that, like, this was directed. I mean, this went through, like, kind of a bit of production hell. Like, it came out in 1999, but it was being talked about as early as, like, 1992 and went through several different people who were going to end up making it. Like, it was originally going to be directed by Richard Donner, written by Shane Black. Yeah, and it was going to star Mel Gibson. And then...
Crazy.
Yeah, and then they left to work on Maverick. And then Tom Cruise was going to be in it, but then he was in Mission Impossible. And so then that's when Will Smith and Barry Sonnenfeld started getting involved, which you have to think
the Men in Black team.
That's the thing. It's like Men in Black was like, you can't understate how big of a cultural phenomenon Men in Black was.
It changed the course of everything.
Yeah. Like I'm not sure I would have been born if it wasn't for Men in Black. So, I mean... Honey,
let's go see Men in Black, and then that was the most passionate night.
Thank you, Mike.
They name you Wilson after the pug.
So, like, I mean, Will Smith and
would Men in Black have come out when Trace was conceived?
I think I was already either being.
I think you were in the oven.
Okay. Yeah, I think it was
July 97.
Yeah, I was already in there. But I mean, putting Will Smith and Barry Sonnenfeld back together for another movie is like, oh yeah, no brainer. Like Men in Black was such a huge hit. This has got to be a surefire fucking success.
And it's like the same like dynamic too, where it's like Will Smith plays like funny, you know, witty, what's that called, comic relief, and he's paired up with like an old white man.
Yeah.
But Kevin Kline isn't the, like, grumpy, like, Tommy Lee Jones of Men in Black. Like, he's a little more, like, fun. Like, he's not quite the, I got like, the straight man of, like, to his comic relief, you
know?
He's not like
a curmudgeon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I also think that, I do think that, in general, his disposition is grumpy, but there's so much campy drag mixed in this movie that like you don't realize it because you're like, oh, he's dressed as a woman with foam boobs.
Kevin Kline is a master of disguise in this film.
Oh yeah. I mean, and like there's stuff in this movie that like it teeters on being something cool. Like it's almost good, almost, I feel like.
I was like gagged by like the way that it's kind of body horror vibes. Like, you know, your main villain is like rolling around on like he like lost like the whole bottom half of his body. He talks about losing his balls. Like he's like rolling around.
I can make a robot penis, don't you think?
Yeah. Oh my god, stop. But yeah, he's like rolling around on like a crazy steampunk contraption wheelchair, and then it turns into like wild metal legs, and just I was like, okay, I just feel like I recently worked on the set of a film, so I know that like green screen stuff is kooky. Like making this happen seems like so hard.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
and like body horror, literally, the movie opens with a decapitation.
Yeah, I was like,
I mean, the decapitation thing with like that's the very opening scene. I was like, kind of weird. And then, but the moment I knew that this movie was not what I was like thought I was in store for was the scene where they are projecting the image of
the head,
the last image, but from this man's eyes via projector.
Fucking screamed. Like I never. If I'm like not with, if I'm by myself watching something, I never like audibly react. But I was like sitting in here with like headphones on, like. I was like, what?
Literally,
at
what
the
is,
sight of that.
What does Will Smith say 100 times? That he's like, that is a man's
head. He says it
head.
Like 4 times. Like, honestly, pretty good bit just because he says it so much. But like, I love the way that they like try to scientifically.
First human
like,
head,
try
huh?
Try to scientifically yeah. explain away like why this is.
As if that
as
makes,
if
makes fucking
sense.
That makes sense to me.
Like.
That is science.
Like it's like
to
oh
me.
It's refracted up it's upside down because it's refracted weird and then they turn the head upside down and then it's blurry. He's like, you got to put the glasses on.
Like that makes sense to me. That literally, I feel like I learned that in an art history class.
God. But
I was sold. That's real.
As
science.
As we all might know, this movie was a bomb at the box office, or at least a disappointment.
Yeah, it still it profited, which is great. Yeah.
It made a good 30 million.
Well, it made 113.8 million domestically and 108.3 million overseas for a total of 222.1 million. So it did profit, but they for a movie made for 170 million, I'm sure they were looking for a little bit more.
They weren't making sequels.
No, they were not making any sequels. It got a bunch of worst picture awards at the what the raspberries or whatever.
Do you know who accepted them?
Oh, I did read about this, but if you would like to share.
So this is essentially the only thing I can realize. I guess you can compare it to like a modern, like a 21 Jump Street type thing where the Wild Wild West was a show from the 60s. And from what I can tell, like was not this like had, I don't think it had the steampunky type shit in it with like spiders yeah. and stuff, but it starred Robert Conrad as Jim West, and accepting the awards for worst picture at the Razzies was Mr. Conrad.
He showed up to accept the Raspberry Awards because he was so disappointed with the movie that he wanted to make a statement by accepting the awards and then hand delivering the awards to the people responsible for them.
Wow.
He was offered a cameo as President Grant, but turned it down when the producers wanted him to read for the part. He was outspoken in his criticism of the film, which now is a comedic showcase for Will Smith. So this show wasn't a comedy. He was not opposed to casting a black actor as Jim West. The African-American casting of that role is probably and should not be an issue. I think casting of Smith is the issue. I appreciate his popularity. However, I prefer an actor with more athletic prowess. He's a good comedian, but just not my choice to play my role. That would be a Wesley Snipes body with a Denzel Washington what? Head.
Okay, so he wants a very Wild Wild West 1999 of him to assume.
I know
he
wants
put
a Frankenstein
body.
Yeah.
Wow.
Conrad was also offended by the racial overtones of the film. There's a reference in it to a racial slur. Conrad said, "I hope it's not in the final version." Oh damn, he watched like a test screening. I said, "Why are we going in this direction? Why not just play Jim West black without explaining it?" He also criticized the casting of Brana as a double amputee rather than a little person actor in the role of
wow.
Loveless. Michael Dunn did such a great job playing Dr. Loveless, and he was by far the best villain on the show, Conrad said. There are many talented dwarfs, but they wanted Kenneth Branagh. In a New York Post interview, Conrad stated that he disliked the film, and contractually, he was owed a share of money on merchandising that he was not paid. He also had a long-standing feud with producer John Peters. He was dating my 17-year-old daughter, Conrad explained, saying he was divorced when he wasn't.
Oh my God.
So that brings us to John Peters, producer of this movie. An absolute fucking
Karl,
piece of
did,
shit.
Did you... I don't know if you watched the long Kevin Smith video that Mike sent. No, you didn't need to. It was kind of long.
Can I just have to say, like, just pause real quick. I don't watch movies. I don't know anything about movies. I literally had saw Pacific Rim in theaters like 12 times because it was like moving me in a way that I was not ever familiar with. And like since then, I hadn't seen many before that, and I really haven't watched many. Hey,
I mean, I don't really listen to Blink 182, so.
okay. So we're all masquerading here. Yeah. So I don't like obviously I know who Will Smith is. I'm not a fucking idiot. But like anything behind the scenes, I'm like I literally just found out like what all these people do when I worked on that movie set two weeks ago. Like I didn't know anything.
I mean the only names that you really need to know here are like the stars. Like the name John Peters didn't mean anything to me either before watching this.
It shouldn't mean anything.
But I would love to know why he's bad.
So John Peters was Barbara Streisand's hairdresser. I watched a full interview with John Peters in which I'm 99% sure he vetted. Actually, I'm 100% sure he vetted all the fucking questions. To like, because every single time he'd be like, because they'd be like, not like casually like segued in. They'd be like, so, have you ever practiced martial arts before? Like, what? Why are you bring? And then he goes, yes, I have actually. I'm a great martial artist.
Yeah, that's not a normal question.
You've never been asked that in an interview, Karl?
Never. I pray to God someone listens to this and does ask me that one day, though.
So prior to becoming a producer, Peters was a hairdresser for Barbra Streisand. He designed a short wig that she wore in the comedy For Pete's Sake, and as a result, they began a relationship. He later produced Streisand's studio album Butterfly and gained a producing credit on Streisand's remake of A Star Is Born 1976, although the extent of his contribution has been disputed. So he also gets a credit on the Bradley Cooper A Star Is Born, which he had no working on at all. He has several sexual harassment allegations from producers like an assistants and shit over the years, and so he's credited on A Star Is Born but did not receive certification from the PGA. Director Bradley Cooper said he did not know of the sexual harassment allegations against Peter, and Peters was not present on the set but received a producer credit because he controlled the rights to the 1976 film.
The movie business is so fucking stupid and doesn't make any sense.
I know.
So it's in the rotted. Early 90s, it's rotted from the ground up.
It's so stupid.
It's awful. It's the dumbest fucking people get control.
Literally, also, it's so full of nepotism. It's disgusting, and it's so full of nepotism on every level. So I applied for this job working as a member of the COVID team on a Lifetime movie, and I was like, it was one of those things where I was like, I don't have a lot of film experience, but like my resume is iconic. So, you know, I do the interview, I get the job, I'm happy for it. I'm like, okay, it's money. I need money. That's amazing. Well, 1 week in, someone on our team gets fired, and they hire an 18-year-old kid that just graduated high school. And I was like, I was nervous. I thought maybe I wouldn't get this job. And here I'm working with a high school graduate. I'm like, what? I'm like literally like banging my head on the wall. I'm like, kill me now. This is so stupid.
God, yeah, it is so fucking ridiculous.
Yeah.
So in the early 90s,
they hired the
John...
kid because his brother was the guy who got fired.
Oh, okay.
Hey, well, if his brother sucked, maybe his younger one.
Yeah, it's a weird. In general, that's like a spark note version of the story, but like, yeah, it's stupid. I'm like, oh my God, the nepotism is insane.
Yeah,
it's
everywhere in the film. Like, everywhere you look, it's someone is related to somebody or knows somebody in the industry. Like, that's all it is.
Or just like, you worked on a job doing this job. Like, you worked on a film set doing this job, so I'm going to hire you on this other film set doing this other job that wasn't that, but since you've been on a set before, you kind of know what you're doing. I'm like, that's not right. That's not real. That's not how that works. I can't go, like, play bassoon because I play guitar. Like, you know, it's crazy. It's so crazy, but okay, I'm sorry to interrupt.
You know, one day you're in prison for gang activity and you get out. And then you're making wigs for Barbra Streisand, and then you end up buying the rights to Superman in the early 90s.
Yeah, I'm reading a section of Mr. John Peters wiki about the Sandman, and it is fucking crazy. Yeah,
that he commissioned a script for... I don't know anything about the Sandman comic books.
Me neither.
But what all I know is that like from everything I've told, it is... reportedly unadaptable as a movie. They're making it into a Netflix show right now. Oh, I don't know anything, but it's like apparently just impossible. And Neil Gaiman claims that not only the worst Sandman script I've ever seen, but quite easily the worst script I've ever read.
Yes, yes. And they say that it gets worse and worse. It says, but Sandman movies, they just got increasingly appalling. It was really strange. They started out hiring some really good people, and you got Elliot, blah, blah, blah. Never mind. It just is bad. It just got worse and worse, which is honestly iconic.
So his Superman movie, they get Kevin Smith to write. And, like, this isn't my story to tell, really. There's a 20-minute, 2 9-minute videos on YouTube where Kevin Smith tells the story in detail. Whatever you think.
You know who Kevin Smith is?
Yeah, he's
Karl.
Clerks and Jay and Silent Bob, right?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
He's that guy. Yeah, whatever. He's kind of cringe, but I think he's kind of funny.
Clerks
in
was well, I Clerks and Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back were formative for me as a child.
Me too, but like I look back on them era, like yeah. And I'm like
yeah.
When I watched it now.
I watched Clerks recently and I was like,
the only thing I remember from Clerks is the salsa shark thing where the guy's like got the chip and the salsa and he's like, I think we're gonna need a bigger boat. That's like all I think, and that's like an invasive thought I think about it all day, every day.
I like really respect what Clerks did for like independent movie making, but like as a movie,
I bet it's really bad.
But like that video with, I wanted to mention that video with Kevin Smith telling that story, because like it was like really funny, honestly. Like, he's a really good storyteller in that video, and I was thinking it came from an era when Kevin Smith was not the Kevin Smith that he is today, which is just kind of a
Kevin Smith
makes me cringe.
Tweets every time a Disney owned Marvel or Star Wars thing, like the finale of The Mandalorian or fucking WandaVision, a selfie of him like red in the face, like tears coming down. He's like
just crying.
Just watched WandaVision.
Okay, I do that, but with reality TV. I did that with season 2 of Legendary on HBO Max. I took a selfie because I was like sobbing, and then I just like kept taking more selfies because I kept feeling more expressions, and then I tweeted a pic of my camera roll that was like me experiencing every emotion. So
maybe I need to start trying.
You should.
This.
I recommend it. It's fun.
Every time you cry, take a picture, post it publicly.
I don't do that. But like sometimes when I find myself like comically sobbing, it does like help me feel better to be like, I am looking insane right now. I'm gonna take a selfie, like an out of body experience, being like, okay, zoom out. I look so stupid.
So in that story, Kevin Smith gets hired. They're preparing a Superman reboot, and Kevin Smith tells them that their script for it sucks, and they're like, all right, well, if you want to do it, you got to meet with producer John Peters. And John Peters has he has three notes for the script. He wants Superman can't wear his costume
at all.
Nope.
No.
Superman can't fly, and he suggests that Sean Penn is right for the role because he saw Dead Man Walking, and in that movie had the eyes of a caged animal, a fucking killer.
What?
This is an insane person.
So definitely the guy that should have been handling Superman.
And his other note was that I want you to introduce a giant spider in the third act for Superman to fight.
Is that true?
Yes.
He told Kevin Smith that Superman needs to fight a giant spider.
But that's Wild Wild West. Yes. Oh yes. My God. I'm gagged.
So the Superman project got abandoned. They trashed the script. Kevin Smith didn't end up working on it, and John Peters didn't end up working on it. But
John Peters owns the rights to, like, he gets this same bullshit credit on like Man of Steel and Superman Returns.
Oh yeah, he does have credits on those. Yeah.
It says Peters was banned from the Man of Steel set by Christopher Nolan.
Thank you, Chris.
Does he have a credit on the Justice League?
No, it's weird. I've looked into this stuff. Like, he has, I think it's if it's Superman. Like, weird. It's like, for some, it doesn't have Batman v Superman either.
How does a hairdresser own Superman?
I don't fucking know. It's so crazy.
That sentence is like, okay, so my whole thing is I have a really loose grip on reality, period. When I hear shit, when I find out shit like this, it just gets looser. And looser. And one day it's just not going to be there at all.
What?
So the movie,
finding out this world is not what you thought it was.
It's so not. Like, everything I know about something making quote unquote sense is senseless. Like, that's just not how it is at all, ever.
So the movie opens with a bar shootout after the decapitation, where Will Smith is like, he's getting it on with a chick.
It opens, but yeah, period. It opens with him in a water tower.
Hell yeah. Hot.
Because I was literally like, how did we go from decapitation to like sexy time in the water tower? And also, there is actually a really, I don't think Will Smith is very funny. Like, his,
the Animaniacs are there. No, he's got that same energy as like The Rock does now.
There's like something about
that. I have to be cool. And it's like, that's not.
Yeah, goofy comedy, goofy physical comedy is not funny to me. But there is a funny scene where he's like pretending to still make out with this girl in the hot tub, but he's like looking out the little hole in the hot tub.
Pretty funny.
I was like, okay, I'm into that. That's actually making me LOL.
I thought Will Smith like gave this movie more credibility than it might not have if without him, just because he does have charisma at least. He's a pretty charming actor.
He sells it. He sells it.
He sells it pretty well. Him and Kevin Klein both, honestly, like are pretty right for the roles. It's just the movie is just pretty flat.
What's funny is Kevin Klein straight up said, "I was too good for this." Which fucking rules.
I read on the IMDb trivia that when Will Smith asked his mother what she thought of the movie, she replied, "You've done better, baby."
Oh my.
That's so sweet.
God. Only a mother could say that.
And like, only when you brought up the box office failure, it says that it's commonly joked that the only reason this movie earned any movie at all is because unaccompanied minors would buy tickets to this movie, then use them to sneak into screenings of South Park, Bigger, Longer, and Uncut, and American Pie.
Yes, because this and South Park came out the same weekend. And so kids were sneaking into South Park by buying tickets to Wild Wild West. Yeah, a movie so a movie that already was not making the money they wanted it to was like a lot of those tickets were being bought by kids to go see South Park.
Hell yeah. South Park movie rocked.
South Park movie's so fucking good. I've been thinking about because Matt and Trey kind of fell off like with their politics in the last like few years, I feel like, sometimes.
They're sordid figures.
But like I still love that movie, and I think Book of Mormon rules too.
I don't know about that.
I've never seen Book of Mormon. I don't know about that.
Oh man, Book of Mormon can't be a movie, but
oh my god,
this movie,
the Dr. Loveless man,
Kenneth Branagh
is hot.
Oh yeah, he's like a handsome fellow.
I cannot believe this.
He directs Shakespeare movies, and for some reason chose to do this. He apparently went into deep research on the American Civil War.
I'm glad someone did their homework. Because, like, I didn't, like, I just didn't know. As a child, I did not understand this. I was there for Will Smith, and I was there for the toys at Burger King. I was there for the big spider. I didn't, like, know about any of that. So at least someone did their research.
Well, and so, like.
You're like, wait, President Grant didn't see a giant spider?
This movie has such a weird tone to it, and that's partially because it underwent like really extensive reshoots to make it funnier, because test audiences apparently like were not sure if it was supposed to be a comedy, and the original script of it even was like not really a comedy at all. It was more just like a drama mystery, I think, with some sci-fi elements. And so like it kind of really just got turned on its head in production, and that's why it ended up so fucking weird, and with the giant spider. And with all just, like, the crazy, like, science gizmos and shit, and, like, the attempts at comedy.
It makes you think, like, does John Peters know anything about, like, what he's working on? Like, source material? Or, like, as I can't imagine they were putting that kind of, like, techno shit in a 1960s Western show.
No. Yeah, no. I assume he has no knowledge of any of the source material, these properties that he is being given the reins to.
And, like, he apparently freaking, he makes Kevin Smith read the script or something to him. Because he's a baby and can't, like, read
himself. He said he doesn't want to read it. He doesn't like reading scripts themselves. He makes the writers read the script to him.
Who said that?
John Peters.
Oh my god.
And so John Peters, but like he, in the opening when like Superman's planet gets blown up, he called him Kal-El, and John Peters was like, "Who the fuck is Kal-El?"
No. I don't need to know people like this man exist. I was blissfully unaware.
I watched a 12-minute interview with him, and he's like a real person, and he just lies. He like wanted to talk about like his exes, I guess, in that interview, because he goes like, "Is it possible to have a friendly relationship with an ex?" And he's like, "Yeah, I do." It's like, I know a lot of the great guys, the ones I still give money to.
God, I'm a fucking freak. And like, it's like this with, I feel like it's like this with every industry too. Like, if you want to be a part of, or like be more interested in like the film business, the music business, it's like every person you end up reading about is like some kind of piece of shit, it seems like.
I'm like, okay, so I Googled him and I'm on The Hollywood Reporter. There's a piece about him from January 12, 2017. The title is, in quotes, "I am the Trump of Hollywood." The byline is, "The reclusive and outrageous John Peters is still rich, period, really rich." And then the like little blurb at the beginning says, "In his first interview in 10 years, with a loaded gun on the coffee table, the legendary former hairdresser turned producer and studio chief opens up about voting for Donald, kept secret from the quote-unquote love of his life, Barbara Streisand, his feud with Peter Goober, and how it feels to collect huge paychecks on Superman movies for doing nothing."
God. What a fucking scumbag.
Like, just the worst. Literally like the scum of the industry. God, what a fucking freak.
So Kevin Kline and Will Smith run into each other while they're working a mission separately, where Kevin Kline is undercover in full drag, got nice styrofoam titties, looking good. looking hot.
Not looking too bad, honestly.
I think he looks busted.
No, he looks busty.
That too.
And every guy in the bar wants a piece of it.
It's true.
I'm like, oh. And then Will Smith and him run into each other. And then when the shootout breaks out. Also, like, another weird technology thing in this is the guy with the like horn coming out of his ear.
The way that the side of his face is like weird looking, they like made him veiny and strange. I was like, I don't like looking at this. And they show it a lot.
I mean, it was pretty impressive, like practical makeup effect they want to show you,
I guess. This looks good on someone's resume.
So Kenneth Branagh hit Dr. Lovelace, then sends like a train full of explosives into the saloon and blows up. And
I just want to say, I totally lost the plot of this movie somewhere in the middle. I understood the gist.
Kenneth Branagh wants to take over America with a spider.
He wants to make the president give him the country.
Make me president.
Yeah, I got the gist of that. Yeah, it's like Will Smith kind of fighting Kenneth Branagh because he's trying to like take over the country or something with a giant spider. But then some of the specifics, I'm like, why is Selma Hayek here again?
That's a
like,
great question.
Dad's an expert in hydraulics.
And he's working for Mr. Lovelace.
We gotta rescue
him. But it turns out that it's not his dad. The plot twist is that's her lover.
She's been
great shit.
What's it called? Honeypotting them the whole time.
Is that what that's called?
I think so.
Is that what that is? The only time I've heard that term was the 2014. They had the 2014 film, The Interview.
Same. Not the term. But so Will Smith just walks into the fucking White House.
Yeah, there's a lot of that.
Yeah, he does. He just walks up to the White House. Oh, and Kevin Kline's playing a dual role.
That's so goddamn crazy, and it's not, like, addressed that much, I feel like.
No, it is not. He's playing the president and the other guy.
Artemis Gordon.
That's his name.
So, Will Smith walks into the White House.
Is he playing the president?
He plays the real president, too, and he plays him when he's, like, pretending to be him. Like, he's doing green screen.
Does he really?
Yes!
Yeah. That's why there's so many bits of them, like, disguised. That's why there's so many bits of him disguised as the president. It's because he is playing both.
But that was also offered to the real, to the original Will Smith actor from the TV show.
Whoa.
Like, it's insane.
That's a lot of work. They just really made this so crazy. It did not have to be this crazy.
So much. It's insane. It's so much extra effort and like Kevin Klein's right. Like, he is too good for this because he's putting double work in this where he's doing disguises the whole time. He's got, like, five different costume changes throughout.
I kind of just want to go through, like, I kind of want to go chronologically through the different, like, set pieces in this. So what happens, there's, like, so some of the things I most remember, even though I just finished watching it, like, earlier this morning, it's all kind of, like, faded from my memory already. The part where they are, like, stuck together with magnets around their necks, and they're trying to get off of each other.
Yeah, that's not chronologically. That's, like,
if we start yeah, there, I, though, I, that's fine.
Yeah. Honestly, I'm really only interested in talking about, like, stuff like that and the giant spider, because I have some thoughts about the giant spider.
Yeah. Well, I want to just bring up that, these are, like, my favorite types of IMDb trivia, which is that it says Will Smith and Kevin Kline both starred in Disney remakes. Smith in Aladdin and Kline in Beauty and the Beast 2017. And then it says Salma Hayek also starred in a Disney movie too, G-Force.
If you want a good piece of IMDb trivia that's on this page, I got one for you right here. This is the best thing I've ever read. I saved it for this conversation.
I hope it's what it is. I know what it is.
I'm sure. Lovelace kills McGrath's men with what he refers to as a tank. In reality, tanks weren't invented until World War I, around 50 years after this movie takes place. However, since this is a fictional story, anything is possible.
Yes.
Okay. I was looking at the one right above it that says, this movie is featured in episode 257 of the quote-unquote bad movie podcast, We Hate Movies. So, like, I think we gotta...
I'm gonna listen to that.
I mean, I can add...
Let's add it. We gotta add it.
I think...
This movie is featured in the episode 80-whatever of Cinema of the State.
I have a question. Is G-Force the movie about guinea pigs?
Yep.
Yeah.
Selma Hayek's in that?
I guess
she
so.
She voice acts?
A lot of people.
I would
are
love
in
to
G-Force.
Know the rest of the cast. Yeah, Will Arnett, Penelope Cruz,
Zach Galifianakis, Tracy Morgan, Sam Rockwell, Nick Cage.
Sam Rock. What year was G-Force?
2009. John Favreau, yeah. Steve Buscemi.
What was the Good budget?
Bill Nighy. Let's see. Not the science guy.
We
the
find
British
out.
Guy.
We literally find out that adjusting to inflation, G-Force was the most expensive production. Ever made.
Budget $150 million.
Fuck.
Made $292 million, so did not profit. You have to double your budget in Hollywood, is the saying. God.
My thought on the giant spider, because this is the centerpiece of this whole conversation and this whole movie.
Yes.
Is that I kind of like the giant spider. I'm kind of with the big spider.
Can I tell you? I love when things are big, and it's cool that this is big.
It's
but
very
I will
cool.
say, it's like a steampunk wet dream, and I don't live for that.
I don't know if I mean.
But you're happy that someone who did watched this and was like,
yeah. As someone who has watched all of Steampunked, the steampunk reality show on Netflix, I know that there is an audience for this kind of thing, and I'm glad that they got their jush on their life. But, like, I don't think... It's just not for me.
I have no particular affinity for steampunk, like, or anything against steampunk, really.
I see a bunch of gold metal cogs on the wall behind you, so I know that you're lying.
Wait, do you really?
I know.
Where'd those come from? I think what I like about the spider is, like, how surprisingly, like, decent it looks for a movie from 1999.
Yeah, like it's very believable.
The special effects in this are like, I mean...
$170 million.
I was about to say, good lord, they should look fucking good for $170 million. But the movie, like, kind of holds up special effects-wise. Like, that giant spider is, like, pretty believable.
Yeah.
Some of the green screen doesn't look great.
Well, that's
but...
because they smartly, like, do a lot of interior stuff where you're inside the spider and that's all physical.
That's cool. Like, it has, like, a like some cool practical design work and, like, that's strategic movie making.
Well, Trace, production design, do you know who did it?
No.
Production design was done by a man named Bo Welch, who's Barry Sonnenfeld's regular production designer. Worked on Men in Black, worked on Adam's Family, Adam's Family Values, and directed a 2003 film called The Cat in the Hat.
Oh my god.
I'm losing my fucking mind here.
I literally, no.
It all goes back to my boy, Mike Myers.
Karl, I just need to tell you, this is the craziest movie we've ever talked about, and you're here for it.
I feel blessed and cursed.
You gave me free reign. Like, you, next time if you want to pick the movie, or you, but you were like, let whatever you guys want to do, and I was like, Wild Wild West.
I mean, I'm glad that we arrived here, but I just really am going to be thinking about it for too long after the
fact. It's going to occupy my entire week. I'm going to be at work, yes, telling people, like, have you seen Wild Wild West? Like, I have a lot of information about that movie that you might be interested
currently,
in.
Currently, the Jurassic Park cartoon is ruling my world, so I cannot wait to pivot to Wild Wild West 1999. Y'all need to watch Camp Cretaceous. It's fucking crazy as fuck.
All right, well...
The Jurassic Park cartoon?
Yeah.
Do I need to watch the Jurassic World 2?
No.
To understand the continuity?
No.
Okay, cool.
It's actually, all you need to see is Jurassic World 1, because this, like, okay, coincides with the events of that.
Okay. I've seen that.
Remember when, Trace, you'll remember the Twitter discourse among Jurassic World, among the girl who gets eaten
by
a dinosaur?
Who, she didn't deserve that.
She didn't, but I just was like, dinosaurs aren't thinking about... Who they're getting killed.
Yeah, they're not thinking about the poor babysitter that was using her phone too much. Yeah. This I will agree, like, with that statement, yeah.
Dinosaurs don't give a shit.
Yeah, I just remember...
I would say most people who get killed by dinosaurs in those movies didn't deserve it.
Yeah, I love... That's such a product of the time where people were, like, truly deeply analyzing, like, the offense versus the punishment for that character. Like, well, yeah, it was brutal to watch her get thrown around by pterodons and then eaten by the mosasaur, but at the same time, like, it's not the dinosaur's fault.
And, like,
they were hungry.
Like literally throughout the entire...
And also
franchise.
The pterodactyl that grabbed her also got eaten, so it's like, you get what you deserve.
Comeuppance.
Yeah. Comeuppance.
Comeuppance.
I don't remember how this movie ends, but I want to give it, like, a 40 out of 182.
It ends with the surrendering of America to Kenneth Branagh, who then says, we're going to give this half of the country back to Mexico, this half back to England, this half's going to Spain. It's real fucking bonkers shit.
Is that how it ends?
Well, no, that's what happens. And then Will Smith takes a page from Kevin Kline's book in drag and does a distraction. And then they have another giant spider set piece where they... crash the spider. Kenneth Branagh becomes a spider himself.
Yeah, he becomes a spider. He becomes a miniature spider.
Yeah. And then they defeat him, and then Salma Hayek's like, by the way, boys, I don't actually have a crush on either of you. I've been married to my dad this whole time.
Yeah, that's what she
this
says.
This is the most botched explanation of the end of this film. Because I remember ending well.
And then
it ends with them being like, another adventure. Also, can I just say the opening credits for this is, like, really weird.
It's long. It kind of looks
really long.
It's Tarantino-esque.
It's very Tarantino-esque.
It's like a comic booky, like, trying to like, do like comic book panels.
It's like close to like something like a comic book slash like crossed with like a blaxploitation movie, which is like something Quentin Tarantino channels sometimes. So it's like it feels like that. Very strange, but I do think the credits have something that more movies need, which is a rap song summarizing
a Will Smith rap
the events of the movie. We need more we need more rap songs that summarize the plot of the movie that you just watched over the credits.
I agree. That's one of the only things I enjoyed about the Aladdin remake is the Will Smith Friend Like Me remix in the credits, where he's like, anything in your range, even climate can change, you ain't never had a friend like me. I'm like, hell yeah.
Is that real?
I didn't know about that.
Yeah, DJ Khaled produced it.
Holy
That's
shit.
Okay. See, I feel like back in the day, there was just like such an emphasis on like the movie, the blockbuster original song. And I miss that.
It's dead. I miss it.
It's dead.
It's such a fun genre of music.
Bring back the toys, bring back the tie-in games, and bring back the blockbuster songs. That's all we want from Hollywood.
I want a THQ video game, but I give Wild Wild West, I'll give it a sweet little 17 out of 182.
Okay, well, as someone, I get the gist of what's happening here, and as someone who has not seen very many movies, I'm gonna give this, I'm gonna give this a 100 out of 182.
Yeah!
I'm happy to have seen it all. And
I'm glad I finished it.
If it ever comes up in conversation, I'll be elated to contribute.
You know what? I'll bump mine up to a 45 out of 182 just for the song.
Okay, yes. Yes.
I'll say that mine was a 10 that was bumped up to a 17 by the song.
Okay.
I'm not adjusting mine for the song. I'm a genius and I took the song into account immediately.
Karl is smarter than us.
Just older.
So, next week's song is previously mentioned 6/8. We in for a good ride there, Karl?
Yeah, it's dark and mysterious.
Uh oh.
It's dramatic.
I like when Blink gets dark.
Yeah, they like that too.
And we're watching another film starring a rapper.
No, we are. Yeah. We are
8 Mile.
We're watching 8 Mile.
I don't like that man.
No?
No, not a fan.
I don't either.
He's funny to make fun of to me.
Yeah.
He's a punchline for me.
Yeah, he sucks.
Yeah. The film
But have fun.
No, it'll be great. The film was picked by next week's guest, Manuel Covarrubia. My buddy, honestly. That's all he is.
Trace's friend.
Yeah, Trace's friend is coming on the podcast. What else
Verified
is the podcast
on Twitter for being Trace's friend?
What else is a podcast for than just to like bring your friends on sometimes and then?
That's actually so funny you say that, because I really, with my pod, I've been venturing into like the people that orbit my friends, but I haven't really brought any of my close friends on.
Oh, see, we've been doing the opposite. We bring all our close friends, and then like just recently we started like reaching out to other people.
Well, I'm honored that you asked me.
But Karl, speaking of your podcast, why don't you promote everything that you have going on? And do
okay, so my name is Karl Kuehn. I make music under the name Gay Meat. I only have 3 singles out under that name. But then I'm also in a long-standing punk band called Museum Mouth. We have a ton of music streaming everywhere. And then I host a podcast with my friend Becca called It Rocks or It Sucks, where we revisit the music of our high school iTunes/iPod, and we decide if it holds up and whether it rocks or it sucks.
All of those things, awesome. I would say, are iconic. Yeah.
Thank you.
I would say they rock and don't suck.
Oh, my God. I think this podcast sucks. I'm just kidding. I love y'all. This has been literally so fun.
Thank you so much.
Every time we have a guest on you that guys, like, I don't know, I'm like, shit, they hate it.
No. Well, I'm here to tell you. I'm speaking for all of them, and it's always fun.
We all have a group chat. We have all had fun every single time. You can follow Cinema of the State on Instagram and Cinema of State on Twitter. I'm Mike McCabe-Sad on those things, and Letterboxd and TikTok. If you really want to see my sick ass vids, follow, baby.
Yeah, I'm gonna promote my Twitter with a very serious intent now that I'm verified. Follow at @TraceTheBurr on Twitter. You'll know it's me.
It would be really funny if Twitter made the mistake, changed it by the time this drops in like 2 weeks,
Shit.
3 weeks.
Made a mistake with yes. One of them got by. Sorry. You'll know the account is mine because it'll have the check mark. You won't make any mistakes.
I'm podcasting a famous video medium. I just rolled my eyes. But congratulations, I'm very happy for you.
That's how I know it was like a genuine eye roll and that you were sick of it.
I'm next.
And not just for like a bit for people.
Mike, if you get verified before me, so help me God.
Me for, because it would, the only thing I have to show is this stupid fucking show. So that would be the funniest. It'd be like, oh, Trace, you could have used this podcast. You didn't have to.
You didn't have to use
diminish your friend's accomplishments.
You didn't have to use your intern writing credits.
We'll miss you.
Bye.
Bye. That was so fun.
Thank you.
Rider. No, you don't want nada. None of this. Six gunning this. Brother running this. Buffalo soldier. Look, it's like I told you. Any damsel that's in distress, be out of that dress when she meet Jim West. Rough neck, so go check the law on the by. Watch your step, we'll flex and get a hole in your side. Swallow your pride. Don't let your lip react. You don't want to see my hand where my hip be at. With Artemis from the start of this. Running the game. James West, taming the West. So remember the name. Now who you gonna call?
Not the GB.
Now who you gonna call?
GW.
If you ever riff with fever, wanna bust, break out before you get bum rushed at
the Wild Wild West.
When I roll into
the Wild Wild West,
when I stroll into
the Wild Wild West,
when I bounce into
the Wild Wild West,
Cisco, Cisco.